Welcome to the FisMaz Show, episode 4. It's going to be an exciting one. I've got a special guest lined up. I'm not going to reveal who it is just yet because he's an interesting character. A rowdy one, someone who's controversial. He's going to be a bit controversial on today's show, but nonetheless, something you can look forward to. Don't forget, keep following us at Podzilla Media and all social media platforms. Don't forget to subscribe. Follow the FisMaz Show on Instagram and for exclusive behind-the-scenes content and updates. And basically news with regards to upcoming shows, what's going to be happening with regards to Podzilla as well as the FisMaz Show. And also make sure that you subscribe to the FisMaz Show on all major podcast platforms, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube. You can find us pretty much anywhere. We love you guys. We've got to look after you. We've got to make sure that you guys are accessible and you guys can find us anyway. So today's show, we're going to start with the roundup. We're going to be rounding up all the hottest news around the world of sports. We're going to start out in London. Coco Gauff made some real headlines. The 15-year-old, yes, you heard right, 15 years old in the main draw of Wimbledon, knocked out Venus Williams in the first round. I mean, can you believe that? 15 years old? Justin, more talent than you, eh? Oh, you've got no talent, so it's all right, you know? So don't worry, my producer Justin has no value, but yeah, we love him anyway. All right, all he can do is smile and look like Alan from The Hangover. But we love him anyway. McGarren's laughing. But yeah, Coco Gauff made headlines. Unfortunately, she's been knocked out of Wimbledon, so that's been one of the major stories coming out from there. Serena Williams has also been doing well, so plenty of really positive stuff out at Wimbledon. But in terms of negative stuff out at Wimbledon, Nick Kyrgios, well, he's always in the headlines, isn't he? He tried to clean up Rafael Nadal. He tried to hit him, and they asked him if he wants to apologize, and he said, "Hey, mate, this guy's won how many major tournaments? And he's how much money does he make? Yeah, I don't think he needs an apology, mate. He can take a ball to the chest." So that's what he said, eh? Something like that, eh, Justin? What do you think? Huh? Justin's got no voice. Just keep quiet.
I like Nick Kyrgios.
Nick Kyrgios?
I like the thing he does between the legs.
Wow. What?
What?
Okay. Moving on. NBA free agency. This is where maybe Justin could add value because he's talking about things in between the legs. Aye, Baba. Oh, PG-18. But NBA free agency. Kawhi Leonard, Paul George doing the things. Wow. I mean, fantastic in terms of obviously how they've gone about their business. I mean, who would have expected Kawhi and Paul George to go to the Clippers? I mean, that was a huge move, a power move. KD and Kyrie Irving going to the Brooklyn Nets. Boogie Cousins to the Lakers. The New York Knicks bombing once again. What does Stephen A. Smith say? No, 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 Boogie Cousins.
I'm having a very bad day. Okay. That's what you.
By the way, just to introduce him, this is our very useless Justin. So, Justin, you've got some value to add with regards to NBA free agency?
Well, that's my sport.
So, tell us did you see that coming? You know, especially Kawhi and PJ and Paul George.
Yes, you could tell. Kawhi was always going to pull a fast one on the Lakers. He was never going to LA. He was never. Why would you want to play with LeBron James and Anthony Davis when you're better than both?
It's a super team. You're better than.
Why do you want to win a title with a super team? Michael Jordan doesn't want to win a title with a super team.
Michael, hey, listen, we can't speak about Michael Jordan when you're talking about mortals, eh? That's a god, eh?
Exactly. And Kawhi wants to be a god like Michael Jordan.
Can he, though?
Well, if he wins in the Clippers, which you will this year.
Are you declaring that right now?
They'll probably win two of the next four.
Wow.
This Clippers team. And LeBron and the Lakers won't win any. LeBron will not win the championship.
You know that I don't mind that. I don't mind. I don't hate LeBron James, by the way. I have a lot of respect for him, but I don't know.
That's because you're a Celtics fan.
No, it's not even that. Like I don't understand why people debate like who's the GOAT. Like, come on now.
Because Michael Jordan is the GOAT, so it's a pointless debate.
Exactly. Can you please tell Shannon and Stephen A. to just nip it in the bud, man?
Hopefully they listen to me. Hopefully they listen to me. Hopefully they listen to me.
I'm going to come here with my GOAT mask as well.
And your little cigar sticking out of it.
Oh, I love cigars. Anyway, New York Knicks, I mean, they thought they were going to strike the jackpot with Kevin Durant, and I know how much you love him. Kevin Durant as well as Kyrie Irving. It didn't happen.
If the New York Knicks were smart, they would go and get Russell Westbrook. And with the pieces they've got, Julius Randle,
actually,
get some shooters in there. There's no reason that team can't make the 8th seed. They need to build a better culture. Stop tanking. You're not going to get anyone next year. Didn't get Zion. Didn't get Luka Doncic in the tank.
Do you know what the scary thing is? I mean, you talk about Madison Square Garden. I mean, the Mecca. And they just suck.
It gets sold out when their best player is Frank Ntilikina. So if they can get a guy like Russell Westbrook,
imagine it.
Ah, they could do something. There's no way. They must go get Russell Westbrook. Trade the house for him. Don't worry about draft picks. The Knicks don't get luck in the draft lottery. Never. They're not going to get Zion. They're not going to get whoever the guy is next year. Just go get into the playoffs. Build a winning culture. Got David Fisdale. It's a good coach.
McCarron, can we just have a round of applause?
Yeah.
Because for the first time since we started doing the FisMaz Show, Justin added value. Ladies and gentlemen, Justin.
I put some sound effects on.
Yeah, put some sound effects on that thing. Yeah, no, 100%. But I mean, that's essentially the roundup from the NBA. So are you saying the Clippers win the title this year?
Yes.
Okay, you heard it here. Justin's call is the Clippers. My call is... I'm going to go Golden State. They're going to come back. They're going to come back. They're going to come. Not, I don't favor them. You know, I support the Boston Celtics. We've got Kemba Walker and Jason Tatum. We're all right.
Come on, surprise us and get the one seed. I don't think that.
Well, you know what? I've got no love for Kyrie Irving anymore. You know, I had mad love for him, but he can foot tech.
Y'all are both disgusting for not mentioning Ogo James.
Woo!
Go James.
What did you say?
Oh, go James. That's who I'm saying.
Who the hell is Ogo James? Who that? Who that? Are we going to start? Yo, you better watch your step, brother. Well, yeah, that's the NBA roundup. And, well, we're going to move on to cricket. Proteas returned home with their tails in between their legs, and it didn't quite go according to plan, but they finished on a high. They beat Australia in their last game, something that they would be proud of. Over in Egypt, Africa Cup of Nations. I mean, who would have thought Bafana would have beaten Egypt, guys? I mean, really?
I called it, by the way. Oh, I did call it. I did.
Justin.
I told you, if we can take Mohamed Salah out of that game, we'll win that game.
You know when and you get the, you know when you get these people now who I called it? When did you call it? With who and how?
Ask anybody.
Did you know that, McCarron?
They called it 90 minutes into the game.
This guy wants to tell us rubbish here. But I mean, in terms of Egypt itself, I mean, there's been a massive fallout there. And luckily, we have a friend out there, Dwayne Dulaka, who shed some interest, would rather, how the public over there are taking things. Let's just have a quick listen to the voice note he sent us.
Well, the fallout from Bafana beating Egypt in Egypt has been immense. I mean, the Egyptian Football Association president, Hani Abu Rida, having fired coach Javier Aguirre and then announced his own resignation out of what he termed was a moral obligation, encouraging other board members to do the same. But you get the sense there's going to be a major shake-up in Egyptian football. The Egyptian football fans themselves seem to be fed up. They feel that they've been sacrificing much. They feel there's no reason to be excited about the team. They feel that they've been deprived of opportunities to support their team in front of their home fans. Some of the former players have come out criticizing the coach, some of the players as well. And there have been many ructions and disruptions in Egyptian football in recent times, going back to the Port Said disaster, in which at least 72 people died, and the subsequent delays, the fan bans, the empty stadiums that were played behind, the fan IDs getting into the venue, the way it's been handled. Egyptian fans are feeling hard done by this. And they're saying that ultimately the football scene here is chaotic. And now it's more about who's to blame. And there's a bit of a war of words raging. But local football, television is airing ads to try to encourage people to get to the venues for the remainder of the Africa Cup of Nations matches, which Egyptian fans seem reticent to do. There's been plenty going on behind the scenes that many have been unappreciative of, including the quality of the football, and of course issues like the football disasters and violence in stadiums, and indeed the sexual harassment allegations against Amir Warda that have been levelled at him, and then being allowed subsequently back into the squad after being banned or tossed out of the squad. So plenty going on in Egyptian football for a team that had won previously 21 of their last 27 Africa Cup of Nations ties, going into the tie against South Africa ultimately out, and it's certainly detracted from the competition as a whole for the Egyptian football fans.
Yeah, interesting that. And we thank Dwayne Dulaka, who's commentating out in Egypt at the Africa Cup of Nations, but it's a mess. It's a mess. And we know how passionate those people are. I'd be scared to even be in the streets, to be honest.
But that becomes the problem when you only have one good player on your team. One world-class player, and you build it all around him.
And we heard the commentator was just loving him. I think 10 minutes in, he had told us maybe about an hour worth of stats about Mohamed Salah. And then he comes in and says, what did he call us? Bafana. Jesus.
That was... I can't believe nobody didn't correct him the whole...
Bafana. I'm like, Hey, man, you know what he needed? He needed someone to walk in there and slap him. He would have said, Bafana, Bafana.
Even if, even when Lorch scored that goal, the way he almost ruined the moment when you see him running towards the corner and then he just screams, Bafna, Bafna, and it doesn't seem right.
Yeah, well, shift our focus quickly before we get ready for our guest. And just talk PSL. I mean, PSL, a lot of the teams have been busy. Orlando Pirates probably been the busiest of the bunch in terms of who they've been signing and who they're going to be looking forward to bringing onto their ranks as they look to challenge for the title next season. And, well, we've got our transfer guru, Menzi Ngobo, the former football agent, former football intermediary, whatever you want to call it. He's had his ears on the ground. And he gave us a bit of a run-up in terms of his top three signings and also a Kaizer Chiefs transfer policy that was found puzzling over the last few years. We're going to start with the transfers, though.
Top three bizarre signings. Top of my list, I'd have to go with Kaizer Chiefs' new Serbian signing, Simeon Rukovic. I think that's one of the most bizarre signings ever. Although he's unproven to us in South African eyes. 27, never played in Africa before. Not much of a proven goal-scoring record with a total of... What, 65 career goals. Never really played Premier Division soccer. It's always been a second tier type of player. I think if Chiefs wants to sort out their goal scoring problems and their problems up front, we really needed to dig a bit deeper into our pockets to find more reputable striker. So that would have to be top of my list as one of the top three most bizarre signings. And then second on that list would have to be Tagofatso Mabasa from Celtics to Pirates. These signings happened way too often. I think he had an okay-ish season at Celtic, but to try and break into that Pirates starting 11 with an average season at Celtic would prove to be very difficult for him to break into that first team. So I think for him, it was a very bizarre move. I understand what it means for him in terms of a career upliftment and a change of scenery and to try and step up his career aspirations as well. But in terms of a proper playing move, I think it's a really bizarre move. If I were him, I would have stuck it out for at least another season, try and really, really cement myself at Celtic, and then see from there where my career might take me. And then third on that list, from the same bunch that moved from Celtic to Pirates, Bongani Sam, the left back. If you're looking at competing for a position like with Umayela, the current Pirates left back who's in the Bafana camp in Egypt, he would have to really pull out all the stops to try and nod his head ahead of Umayela for his starting berth at Pirates. I think it's really bizarre for him, especially at such a young age. He would look to be in a team where he'd be being played a bit more often, be noticed a bit more often, you know, get a bit more games under your belt to try and prove yourself as a seasoned PSL player. I think it was moved too early for him to go to Pirates at this stage. So I think it really makes up my top three for one of the most bizarre signings this season so far. Right, top three PSL signings. I think top of my list has to be Gabudinho Mahangu's move from Wits to Pirates. I think type of striker that he is definitely going to flourish in that new role at Pirates, depending on how they play him. I honestly think he's one of the country's most underrated strikers, a real poacher. He's got an eye for goal. He's a real fox in the box there. I think he wasn't given enough chance towards the latter end of his career at Wits. He's definitely going to prove to be one of the best signings, I think, so far. And then second on my list would have to be Fortune Makaringa's move from Maritzburg United to Pirates. Even though I don't genuinely think he's going to be given the right type of opportunity to flourish, after the season he had with Maritzburg fighting for relegation, I think if he's given enough chance to prove himself at Pirates, he's definitely going to be a force to be reckoned with, depending on, again, on the formation and the system in which they'll play. And I think tie for third for me would be between Abubakar Mubara and Lehlonolo Masalisa. Abubakar Mubara moving back to Cape Town, to Cape Town City, and Lehlonolo Masalisa signing for Chipper United. Again, second would have to be Abubakar Mubara, who, again, I think wasn't given enough of an opportunity to prove himself at Pirates. He's a really good utility player. He can play in midfield. He can play as a fullback. I think under Benny's guidance, I think he's really going to flourish up in Cape Town and with less pressure probably from the fans. I think this might prove to be one of his best seasons in his career so far. And then with regards to Lehlonolo Masalisa, I think he proved again his worth when he was at Leopards, that he can be a real midfield general there. And again, also depending on how Clinton decides to play him at Chipper, with how they've revamped the squad there. And I definitely think this might be a really good season. But there hasn't been any really major signings, I think. But that would have to be my top three so far.
Yeah, interesting thoughts there from Menzi Ngobo from out in Durban with regards to who his top three signings have been of the window so far. And, it has been interesting because Pirates have really made a strong move, but a team that perhaps hasn't made the moves that their fans would have wanted is kind of the Chiefs, because they've signed a lot of players from overseas or for foreign-based players who they don't really know a hell of a lot about. But it's going to be interesting to see how those signings do pan out. Menzi also touched on the fact that Kaiser Chiefs' transfer policy has been a bit of a weird one over the last few years, and I think we need to just hear a clip from him with regards to that specific subject.
Well, Fiso, look, if you ask me about the Kaiser Chiefs transfer policy, I actually don't even think they have one. I think the last time Kaiser Chiefs invested in buying players was during the Mataho and Morgan Gold era, when they put up that formidable defense under Stuart Baxter's guidance. It was Defo Mashamayete, Morgan Gold, and Nomon Dalmato. I think they invested quite a bit of money there that season, and that proved very fruitful after that, because they went on to win the league double. After that, there hasn't been any real financial movement in the market. Yes, we've tried a few strikers here and there over the past couple of years and couple of seasons, but we haven't really spent a considerable amount of money in the transfer market for me to believe that we have a proper transfer policy. I think when it comes to Chiefs, the dawn of the Sundowns era sort of put Kaiser Chiefs under serious pressure to try and compete differently in the transfer market. Well, back in the day, every player wanted to play for Chiefs. So it was easy for them to compete in the market because everyone wanted to go there. So they could sort of like twist the arm of the other clubs into trying to get signatures of players, because players really wanted to go there. And at the time, the scale of the market wasn't that high. You could get players, a good 2-3 players for under a million, 1.5 million at best. But after the introduction of Sundowns, when they went into the market under the guidance or the leadership of Patrice, things really turned lopsided, with players like Uvilagas going for, 14 million rand or something like that. And after that, Chiefs hasn't really been able to compete in the transfer market. And that's been a real downfall for a club like Kaiser Chiefs, because it's hurt them quite a deal over the past couple of seasons, because all the players that Chiefs has brought in have been free transfers. And you know how the saying goes, you get what you pay for. And if you don't pay anything, you don't get anything. And I think it's unfortunate, but it's the truth. Once Chiefs and the board and the chairman and the management of Chiefs decide to restructure the way they buy players, the way they sign players, I think only then will we start to see a change in fortune. And that will definitely mean having to spend money in the market to go and buy the best players of the time.
Yeah, some interesting words there from our transfer guru. Thank you very much, Menzi, for those voice notes with regards to what's happening in South African football with Kaiser Chiefs, with the top three signings. Justin, you don't know anything about discing, man. What do you know? Don't smile.
I'm a Pirate supporter.
Listen, we can't be picking teams here, because now if we say things, then this guy's there, so put Pirates.
Better than Chiefs, right?
I'm not going to argue with you. But yeah, the guest we have today, huge Sundowns fan. He doesn't hide it. He's on social media. He's as loud as ever. I wonder who it is. After this music, you'll find out. Trying to get one specific special guest on the show, and he's a bit of a problem child. He's a hazard when he has his phone in his hand. You're never safe. His name is Lebogang. DJ Naves. He's laughing already because he knows.
I don't know what you're talking about.
The world is not a safe place when he's around. So, Naves, how are you, brother?
Good, thanks yourself, my bro.
I believe you just had a little one, not much sleep. Devin, July, it's all happening,
I don't know what you're talking about.
Are you going to deny it?
I don't know what you're talking about. I'm not denying anything. I'm just saying I don't know what you're talking about.
Okay. All right. All right. I'm going to move on. We're going to leave the family stuff because I know you. Let's talk about your love for football. I mean...
Yeah, man.
I don't know a more diehard football... Let me rephrase. A diehard Sundowns fan. And arguably Bafana Bafana as well.
Yeah, I think I grew up... Like you, we had no other options. All we knew was soccer. So growing up in Kasi, no matter which hood you're from, that's all that was pumped into our heads was football. You go to the stadium, all the adults would sit on the grandstands and all sit on the ground and get to watch the game. And I think that was embedded in me and it's part of my DNA now.
Yeah. I always see you on Twitter when once the subject of Sundowns comes up, if anyone's talking anything funny... you put them down quite nicely.
Yeah, facts are important. You know, like, I've realized, like, especially on Twitter, people on Twitter like the trashy stories, like the non-truths.
Yeah.
The facts are just not cool for them. I don't know why.
Yeah.
Like, facts, like, it's a fact. Like,
yeah.
It's there. Why would you want to hear the lies and not the facts? Weird.
But the one thing that has always intrigued me has been your... I don't want to call it hate... But you just don't recognize Kaiser Chiefs.
I don't. So Kaiser Chiefs fans have the biggest mouths. You know, if they win anything, you're hearing about it for like years to come.
But they haven't. What?
My point exactly. Okay, so it's our turn now. Now it's our turn. We must step on their necks, and we are not letting loose. It's gonna be another dry season.
And I've seen you. You don't let loose. You mean Chiefs fans want to celebrate. So what's that cup there?
Maize Cup.
The Maize Cup.
Kaling Cup.
Makufe Cup. We won the treble, eh? I mean, I don't want to call it their demise, but I mean, geez, they've fallen off the wagon a bit in terms of competing.
They literally
have nothing to say.
I feel bad because I have some friends that play for KZ Chiefs. And I'll be like, yo, I'm about to go in. Unfollow me, mute me, something. And then I go, and then I'll just get somebody swearing at me in my WhatsApp, and I'm like, okay, it hit home.
Yeah, I know. But I mean, let's focus on Sundowns, the team you support, the team you love. There was always success at Sundowns.
Yeah.
But Coach Pizzo took over, and it seems to have gone to a whole new level.
Yeah, definitely. I think with the experience Coach Pizzo took from SuperSport United, going to Bafana, and all the history, basically. He finally came to a point where he had the support, the love, the respect that he needed to do what he wanted to do, and he built the team. I mean, when he came on, I think we were sitting number 12 in the Premiership, and we finished that season at like number 10 or something ridiculous like that. But the following season, he made all his signings, change the team around to start, you know, working as a unit. And he consistently preached that our bigger goal is Africa and the World Club Championship. So it's been an amazing ride. I mean, it's good and bad because he's gotten us to so used to winning that if we lose, it's a catastrophe. Yes, we get over it, but we want to win every game. We're spoiled.
I'll make sure that when you guys lose... I just go on my Twitter there, I scroll, and I'm like, DJ Naves.
No, so I've learned how to deal with it now. I take an hour to myself just to regroup, and then I just ignore you guys.
Is it that just deep? Like, are you that hurt?
Yeah, it's bad. If there was one thing I could pray to be taken away or hypnosis, was the love for football.
Wow.
It's bad. And then I do like this live commentary thing where... I'm friends as well with a couple of coaches like Rulani.
Yeah.
And I'll trade with him. So we'll go. I go at him and he's like, just calm down. It's just a game. I'm like, no, it's not a game. But he's another passionate one.
Yeah.
He's a better man than me. Come the end of the season, I had told him, if you win, there's no ways I'm going to call you.
Yeah.
I'm actually never going to talk to you again. And the day we won the championship, he called. I was like, you're a better man than I am. Far better.
Yeah, but special coaches you've had at Sundowns. And I mean, let's go back to Coach Pizzo.
Yeah.
Because I've always found it to be an intriguing character. Mm. A character that's not easy to understand.
Yeah.
A character that's perhaps, I can say he's polarizing in terms of the way he goes about his business, but I find him to be fascinating.
Extremely fascinating. You need to listen to the man speak. Don't hear what he says. Listen to what he says. I don't know anyone who is a football addict. Like, I'm nothing compared to that man. That man will watch one game repeatedly and he could tell you, when Pirates attack you on the left, 9 out of 10 times, the ball will either be crossed or cut back. Like, to that point of detail, he's just like, I don't even know what the word is, but he's like football crazy. His house has a small football pitch.
Mm.
It's just like, it's another level altogether.
And I can imagine he's also probably difficult to play for, because not in a bad sense, but in a sense of, he looks like a guy who will demand nothing but the best from you at practice, in your personal life,
100%.
And on the pitch. And some players just cannot handle that.
Yeah, some players, that thing will break you. I mean, it's football is a tough sport. It's not easy.
Wait, I correct you. Football will kill you.
It will kill you. it's not easy because a lot of players are like, you know, sometimes you just want to go hang out with your boys.
Yeah, yeah.
But is it the right thing to do? Because you're figured out, there's girls, there's alcohol.
She's a nyama.
She's a, you know, all of this. And it's like, maybe I should, you know, like, I was reading an article the other day with Coach Pizzo saying he's now trying to cancel camps, which is, in Europe, if you're playing a home game, you don't camp.
Yeah.
You arrive at the training facility at 9 a.m. on day of game and then jump in the bus and then you go off. Whereas here in South Africa, before him was, before some time back, was Coach Neeskens. Johan Neeskens was like, yo man, the discipline out here is bad. You're going to camp for 2 days before the game.
Mm.
So if you played on Sunday and you have another game on Wednesday, you're not going home. You know? So he was like, yo, that guy was strict, man. Like, he was, you know? So I think players in general have to be far much more responsible, take responsibility for their careers as well, you know? I think you're fortunate, Makhane, no coach of Fana no Pizzo, who will just want the best out of you. And half-stepping is just not an option, because then you will bench.
There's something that he likes saying. It's not easy to play for Sundowns.
No, it's not.
That's that sort of thing. I mean, it's testament in what you've just said there, in that the demands are there. The fans expect you to win. The culture has become a winning one. And I guess that's also something that in other teams and in South African society as a whole, you can look at in terms of winning is not just something you wake up and, we're winning. Yeah. No. It has to be ingrained in the culture, in the team, and in people as themselves.
So if you look at it, right, the average season has 29 games. Then you add a couple of cup games. So let's say in a season, one team is playing 40 games. Sundowns guys are playing 60 games in one season.
Yeah.
That's almost double the amount.
It's a lot of games.
It's a lot of games. So when he says it's not easy, it's not from the perspective of Yoguti, no, you don't know how to read our playbooks or whatever the case is. Yes. It's a lifestyle, that thing that you're doing there, because the other day they played 3 p.m. game, cleaned up, back on the bus, airport, gone to Morocco or something.
Mm.
I was like, they just finished playing a game. Yeah, like, where's the recuperation?
Yeah, 100%.
And they're just like, it's not there in the calendar.
Mm.
The calendar is play, move, play, move, play, move. Because it's just that demanding. And once you do that, you realize the sacrifices you make now, you can reap the benefits of it later, you know?
Mm.
How many players in the PSL era, there's a group of Sundowns players that have tasted CAF success, you know, Champions League. It's just them in the PSL era. And that's scary to say. We have what a lot of people will say the best league in Africa, but we're not winning Champions League. And that's a problem.
And I mean, you look at those North African teams and the way they've done it. You've been to North Africa yourself. It's just a different animal out there in terms of the love for the game and the demand for success.
Guys, we game kicks off at 3. We arrive at the station at 3, at the stadium at 3. So that means we're in the stadium at 3:30. Game started already.
Yeah, and we've seen games delayed because of that.
In Egypt, kickoff was 8 p.m. At 2 p.m., the stadium was at capacity.
Yeah.
Capacity.
What?
full at 2 p.m. from 8 p.m. kickoff.
Wow.
There was nobody performing. There was no...
There was no pre-match entertainment.
No pre-match entertainment. They were chilling, waiting for the match.
Yeah.
From 2 p.m. to 8 p.m., singing, lighting flares, going wild.
Yeah.
It's a different, like, it's a different thing altogether. When you land in, we landed in Alexandria. Either Zamalek or Al Ahly.
Yeah.
Those are the two main teams. And when we were playing Zamalek, all the Al Ahly teams were like, fans.
For Sundowns.
And then when you're playing
Al Ahly, yeah.
Zamalek fans are like, yeah. So it's wild. It's different. It's a different way of life altogether. I've never seen a city more congested than Egypt. Cairo, I didn't get to go to Cairo. I was in Alexandria. But it took us a distance of less than 5 kilometers. It took us about an hour and a half.
Yeah, no, I've been to Ismaili and Egypt, and it's the wild, wild west out there.
I'm all right.
I remember we couldn't cross the road for about 50 minutes. We were trying to walk across to a restaurant, and our cab driver had to get into the road and stop the cars. And then he's like, my friend, come across.
Yeah, no.
I was like, really?
It's wild.
Is this life here?
World altogether.
And it looks like people are going to crash, we're going
to
have accidents.
No, they're used to.
They just kind of just go. They hoot and they keep going.
Yeah, the one guy was telling me that apparently they're not allowed to sell new cars anymore. They're not making cars anymore in Egypt.
I did hear that.
Yeah, because
it's pointless.
It's pointless because of the number of accidents. And two, there's no space for them to go to. The guy was telling us they had some German engineers come in to try and sort out the traffic thing of what can we do. And these guys were like, it's working for you guys.
It's fine. It's fine, my friend. Leave it, yeah.
Leave it, yeah.
But I mean, in terms of the experience as a whole for you, I mean, flying up, Sundowns won the Champions League that year that you went there.
I remember clearly I had a couple of bookings for that weekend. And I said to my business partner, Spey, this might be a once in a lifetime opportunity. We might never see another South African team in our lifetime while we're still able to. So I will refund the gigs and I'm going to Egypt. And he thought I was joking. And then I went down and booked my flights, booked my accommodation. And then I also figured I need a visa. Luckily, Tulani, who was at Sundowns.
Tulani Tuso, yeah.
Yeah, Tuso. He was helping and I was like, just stick my passport in there.
Yeah.
The team. And I got my visa in a day.
Yeah.
Crazy. Went out to Egypt, language barrier, but it's okay. We arrived, we landed, we managed to get to the hotel. And then from there, like, first of all, the guys were shocked that I flew myself out there because there was a contingent that had been flown by the president.
Yeah,
and they were staying in a different hotel. And they're like, so wait, you paid for yourself. Why? I'm like, guys, when will we ever get to see this?
Yeah.
They're like, no, it's possible to be done again. I'm like, yeah, but the risk factor of it is that at least with this one time. So it was amazing. I learned a lot about how the team works and how the team travels. To conquer Africa, you need a full logistical team. And when I say logistical, I'm talking a pre-team that goes ahead of time, make sure that the bus is ready and it's the right bus, because there's occasions we've arrived in Africa and there's no windows on the bus.
Yeah.
Type of thing. Yeah. So that, find a training field. You bring, team has to travel with the chef. The rooms, make sure like everybody's on one wing. You don't have players scattered across the entire.
I always thought that the team that's hosting handles all that logistical stuff. Is that not the case?
So we South Africans are too nice, man. So they come here, they get a luxury.
They live nicely.
They live nicely. When we go there, it's not the case. So you end up having to come out of pocket.
Yeah.
To sort yourself out.
Wow.
And then they say complain to CAF, but as you've seen, FIFA has had to take over CAF because
it's a mess.
It's a mess. It's like SAFA. We need FIFA to come in.
Eish, you're going down that road, eh?
It's important. We cannot shy away from these things.
I guess you're moving me on to the next subject. Yeah?
If Bafana loses, do you think Danny Jordan will resign? You don't even say, no, he won't.
No, he won't resign.
Because there's nobody to take responsibility. Look at Egypt. They lost. Entire technical team gone. Entire top-level staff at the Egypt Football Association is gone. They're taking accountability. We're wrong. We made a mistake. We've disappointed the nation. We're out.
And I mean, we speak of disappointment. You know, some other countries look at, okay, obviously you're at home, but you've progressed from the group stages. Some other countries would be like, oh, it's bad, but it's not. It's a disaster for them. Like, it's the end of the world.
Let me ask you this. What happened to all the FIFA projects, that the 2010 legacy? You know why you're silent?
Because I don't know any.
There's none. Where's the money now? That's what they must answer. They're supposed to be just outside FNB Stadium. They're supposed to have built fields.
Mm.
Don't exist.
Yeah.
They're supposed to be a full-on, almost like an
like
academy.
An academy, yeah.
Yeah. Supposed to be there. Doesn't exist. The stadiums that were supposed to be upgraded, the smaller ones, like the one in East London where Cheaper plays, Sisa Dukasi. All those things, there were plans for it. I mean, I think they left something in the tune of $10 million to do all of this stuff. I stand to be corrected. But it's not there.
Yeah.
Who's being held accountable? No one. So, if I could tell you, bro, Safa is an interesting place. You go to AFCON. If you're playing for Sundowns, right?
Yeah.
And when you get there, you guys are booked into a 4-star hotel. You have the chef. Everything is organized. But now you go away with the national team, which should be the next
level. Even better, yeah.
And you're in a 2-star hotel. You're eating whatever everybody else is eating at the hotel. Like, you go to the buffet. It's player, player. Civilian, civilian,
yeah.
Player. Civilians, players, coaching. It's just a mess.
Yeah, I know.
We're in trouble. We're in real big trouble.
Yeah, and it's disappointing, you know, when at times, you know, things like that hinder the national team.
Definitely they do.
And I mean,
how do you expect these guys to perform at their best when they still have outstanding payment fees for games? Like a year ago, we still haven't been paid for
What's your take on that? I mean, a lot of people say things like, well, you play for your country, it's not about the money. What's your take on that?
And my take is this, right? I have no issues with people being patriotic and doing it for the country, but the country must make it conducive for me to be able to do that. So when we travel and get to wherever we're going, we must stay in a decent hotel. It must just be, you know, we must be taken seriously.
Yeah.
But if we're not, then we might as well like fight for some money so that it's worth it.
Mm.
But at the end of the day, it's your job. Football is a job. And it's not like a long-term career. If you're lucky, you'll play for 20 years, which means you break in at 20, you retire at 40.
Mm.
Hardly happens.
Mm.
In this country, you break in at 24 and they want you retired at 34.
Mm. And one of the sad things is that you look at, I mean, I remember reading up about the case about they were trying to alter, you know, in terms of the taxation of soccer players, because you get taxed the same as someone who's going to have a long career, because you fall into that bracket, but your career is only like 10 years max.
Yeah, it's insane. Like, the tax laws are they're open-ended. They don't look at individually. They don't come and say, you're in sports science, it's a career forever, we'll tax you like that.
Yeah.
They just want to know, how much did you make? That's our cut.
Give me my money.
We out. And then when you're done working with soccer and you have nothing, they're done with you.
Tough times, eh?
Definitely. We need to the entire model needs to be relooked at, which is why it just doesn't make sense. You know, like, it just doesn't make sense. You get text of bonus. No, it just doesn't make sense.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's focus on the pitch itself.
Yeah.
Bafana, Bafana. I read a tweet.
Stuart Baxter must go. I stand by it. He could win AFCON, and I still stand by that Stuart Baxter must go.
Can you elaborate?
I don't think we are playing to our capabilities, to our strength. First two games was sit and let them come at us. Hopefully we'll catch them on the counter. All Ivory Coast did was press up higher, which means our defenders couldn't play out the back, couldn't get into the middle, and we couldn't get it to the last third. So the ball stayed in our half of them knocking. And sooner or later, they were going to get the goal. And guess what? They got it. It just doesn't make sense. We beat Namibia 1-0. How are we going to get... Like, the guys have been drilled on defend, 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 and wait. how are we going to score more goals?
Mm.
You know, we need to go at opponents. We need to, the best form of defense is to attack.
And I mean, we have the weapons to do that. This is probably one of our best teams we've had in a number of years.
Guys, we have, if you look at the bench, Thulani Serrero, Sibusiso Vilakazi, Teminkosi Lodge, Temba Mshishi, Mabue, the list is endless of Van Veldveek.
Yeah, Veldveek, yeah.
Yeah, we have the players, man. I just don't understand the strategy of playing like three deep defensive midfielders, playing like, oh, come on, man.
We are Kyle.
No, Stuart Baxter must go.
So even if he wins AFCON, are you...
He must go.
I don't believe it.
I don't believe it. All. Sheikh Mashaba was fine.
But this guy won league titles in South Africa.
So?
So you don't...
He's never won CAF. Doesn't know Africa. He knows PSL. Doesn't know Africa. I'm not saying they must hire Coach Pito, because he doesn't want that job.
Mm.
Well, he didn't use those exact words, but yeah. He said...
he said he's happy, he's laughed.
Happy, he's laughed and said that. So,
I love that clip, eh?
It's amazing, because it's the truth. Yeah. Man. Think about it, like... there's nothing more important, I think, to any human being than being appreciated.
Mm.
For somebody to say, you're doing well, keep going, how can we support you?
Mm.
And that's all you want. But then, why did Sheikh Mashaba get fired?
We don't know.
We were playing amazing football. Yeah. We were attacking.
Yeah.
We were running at people. We beat Nigeria in Nigeria, running at them. They didn't know how to stop us. Then they... come on, man. So, Stuart Baxter must go. Danny Joran must go. Dennis Mumble must go. Those guys have been working at SAFA, right? I hadn't even grown pubes. That's how long they've been at SAFA. Like, have you seen the SAFA Twitter account? I can guarantee you it's somebody old.
No, it's bad. Like, somebody even boasted about, like, SAFA really just needs to hire
people, like,
who are professional.
Who know what they're doing.
Even the Instagram, it's like, what is this, like, post?
Like, I'm telling you now, the problem is, and as well, I say this all the time, that sooner or later, you need to pass the baton on, and the old brigade, now is the time before it turns worse to a place where we won't be able to recoup it.
Hey. Yeah, I'm happy that at the very least we got to where we are. I mean, I didn't see that performance against Egypt coming at all. From how we played but I knew the capabilities were there.
Yeah, I back Bafana no matter what.
And I love that tweet that you posted. You're like, okay, either if I don't like the coach, I still support the team.
I back Bafana no matter what. There's only one national team. We don't have another option. Like, you can't say, no, I support national team B. There's no team B. We have one team. So I'll back Bafana no matter what. I'll back Bafana. But if I don't agree with the coach, I'll also say it, you know. And I'm saying to the guys now, even if he wins AFCON, I stand by my word, he must still go.
And I look at the team and there's one player that, he's my favorite player in the national team, but he doesn't get as much game time as I'd like, you know. And I always find it puzzling in terms of, is he used the right way?
Yeah.
A guy like Thulani Serrero.
I don't understand why Cream is not playing.
He is. Wow. And I mean, you talk about a guy who plays in arguably one of the top six leagues in Europe.
Week in, week out, first name on the starting lineup.
And it's, he can't catch a game.
I agree.
And I'm not saying anyone else shouldn't be playing or whatever. I'm trying to understand the Serrero puzzle that hasn't been solved under a number of coaches.
I don't understand why they don't play Cream. Cream is amazing. He can play as central defensive midfielder, central attacking midfielder. You know, like, Cream is your... I don't know why. I honestly don't know why.
But Bakalang was keen.
I really think Uguti...
Emaz was keen.
Yeah. I really think we're going to lose to Lanisera after this.
I also have that feeling.
Yeah, I think he's going to retire from international football. And I don't blame him.
Mm.
In Amsterdam, he's comfortable. Nice house, nice life, nice girlfriend, comfortable couch. I'd rather be sitting on my couch in Amsterdam than warming a bench.
Are you quoting him now from...
No, but I'm being honest with you. Think about it. I tell people this all the time. Even with me locally, there's times where I'm just like, I'd rather be at home than be here. Like, you know, and need to be honest. You can't keep beating about the bush. But the truth of the matter is, nobody has found a way to use him, and that's scary. That is very scary, actually. I don't understand. It's one of our best products.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember when they demoted him to the IX
B-team. Yeah,
he was the first one in practice, and all the junior players were like, why here so early?
Yeah.
It's like, so that when I leave here and I'm going to my next team, I'm still top.
Yeah.
My level is still at top.
Yeah.
Top notch. So for me, that was amazing.
And the
professionalism, and then people saying, no, you must come back home. No, stick it out.
Yeah.
Because when you're there, you're still getting your wage.
Yeah.
They could even make you train with the under-12s.
Mm.
You're still getting your wage.
I mean that leads me to another subject where I remember an issue with Mandla Masango a few years back he went over to Denmark and signed for Randers and was one of their best players in his first season. Then Aalborg apparently were interested in buying him. The club refused, and he just said,
That one hurts me a lot because I know Mandla. I spoke to Mandla, and like, I tried, like, yo, bro, just focus, bro. Like, if it's meant to happen, it will happen. And I don't know. Maybe there's things he wasn't telling me. Rightfully so. I mean, who am I in the bigger scheme of things? And unfortunately, now Mandla's not doesn't have a team.
Yeah, and so much talent, man.
Doesn't have a team, bro.
And again, that's where that professionalism kicks in. You know, you just kind of, okay, cool. The club doesn't want to sign me, but I've got a 4-year contract here, or whatever the contract
face
may
the
be.
Music.
I play.
That's it.
That's that. And if you play, if you play even better, another a bigger club.
Somebody
comes
will come after you. Show up to training.
It's a weird mental approach, isn't it?
Yeah, I was speaking to Percy Tau, with everybody giving him grief about playing in the league he's playing
in Belgium,
and he's like, bro, I'm coming home to retire.
Mm.
I'm not coming home for any other reason.
Yeah.
Same conversation with Bongani Zungu. Bongani's like, they can say, they can talk, I'm like working my socks off.
Yeah.
The team there appreciates me.
Yeah.
And once again, it boils down to that. People want to be appreciated and loved, and they'll give you so much more in return.
Yeah, 100%. And Bafana Bafana, obviously all eyes will be on them to see how far they can progress.
Yeah.
Do you think we can qualify for that next World Cup? Do we have the players to do that?
The players have never been an issue. I just want the coaching is where my concern is. I mean, you have a great bunch of players coming up. Luther Singh.
Mm.
To think, guys, Mubara was playing at the last World Cup.
Yeah.
And he marked Messi out the game.
Yeah.
Fiso Hlanti marked Mo Salah out the game. So we do not have talent.
Mm.
Lucas Radebe played for Leeds. Stephen Pienaar played for Everton. Benny McCarthy has a UEFA Champions League medal. Quentin Fortune played for Man United. You just name it. Like, come on, Phil Masinger, you name it. All these guys have played at the top level. So it's not a lack of talent. I think it's a lack of coaching. I think that's where the problem is. So if we get the coaching structures and everything right, I think definitely we can qualify.
Okay.
Well, and I also think I feel like we need a local South African coach for the national team.
Mm.
Because, like, then you've got to go back to the hood or wherever you live, and everybody you hang around with is going to be like, when will this squad? You're going to feel the pain as well. You know what I mean? Like,
And I saw that tweet you posted. And you're like, Stuart Baxter needs to feel the pain.
He doesn't feel the pain, that man. He goes back to London, there, England.
But he's been living here for so long. Right?
Yeah, but that doesn't change that he's not South African.
Yeah.
He hasn't even taken up the 5-year citizenship thing. You know what I mean? Like, and I'm not saying, like, we don't want foreigners in our country. No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying to you, I think that a local coach who understands the way our boys have been brought up, understands how we want to play itiski, who will feel the pain. Like, makaphumile nje ayelokushini bamthuke. Yes, this. Then, you know, he'll be like, okay, I got to win.
Yeah.
These guys got to win because the pressure's on.
Yeah.
But currently, I don't see it happening with Stuart.
You've got a name or two for us?
For coaches?
Hmm? Give me two. Just give me two that you'd like. DJ Naves, who would you like to coach the national team?
Gavin Hunt. And I'll definitely... it will be a tough negotiation. but I think I could convince Bito to come back.
Big names. Big names, those.
Yeah, proven, those are championship winning coaches.
Proven winners?
Yeah.
Proven winners?
Yeah, they know the boys, they know, I mean...
And they'll demand nothing but the best.
Exactly. I remember I heard a story about Kevin Hunt, one of the players he had just signed, literally signed this week, and a month later came with a brand new convertible BMW, and he slapped him on the back of the head, jumped in the front seat and said, drive back to the dealership, dropped the car off at the dealership, dragged him to the bank, and forced him to buy a building. He said to the banker, what developments are you guys working on?
Yeah.
And this guy mentioned it. Like, all right, cool. He'll take two apartments
in
that. And this guy's sitting there like, do I have a say in this? And he's like, no, sign here. So the guy signed. And the guy's like, to this day, is forever grateful for that because he doesn't even live in those things. They've been earning him money.
Yeah.
He used his entire signing on fee to pay them off.
Yeah.
And they've been earning him money. And he's been playing football for now 10 years. And he's made back what he put into those things, and it's just nice. It's profitable.
Wow, that's an amazing story.
And crazy.
We want to hear more stories like that 100%. In South African sport, where, you know, we don't, we're tired of these, hey man, hey, these stories,
he had so and so,
he had money, he drank it, he did this, he did that. So it's nice that there are people out there that are doing positive things.
100%.
And I mean, and I know you always giving the guys advice. I know you never shy, really. You pick up the phone, you say, hey.
Yeah, man, you can't be, like, if we're friends,
yeah,
then, and if I'm doing something wrong, and if you're not saying anything to me, then we're not friends.
Yeah.
We just know each other.
Yeah.
But I think it's important, like, and I always say this, I've got a barometer, which is my business partner, Spectacular. I wanted to tweet crazy even yesterday.
Yeah.
I read something and I really wanted to tweet crazy, and I was like, but what would Spear do?
Yeah, yeah.
And it was, Spear wouldn't tweet that.
Yeah.
So I left it, you know. But I just think generally it's just, if we're friends, we need to call each other out. If something's wrong, I need to call you and be like, Fiso, you're my boy. What's happening?
Mm.
I don't like this, and so forth.
Yeah.
And then you take it from there. Whereas if we're not friends, then I'll let you fuck up. I mean,
it is what it is.
It is what it is. Yeah.
Look, he's a hazard in terms of, obviously, if you're dancing at a party, mind your own business, he's going to be zooming in on you.
These little people, you play soccer.
He's going to be... Naves, can I finish?
No, I'm just asking.
You know I play soccer. I play with you.
No, you don't play with me.
Naves is the dirtiest soccer player you will ever come across.
I was sold to an international team.
Oh, he wishes this
I
guy.
I had to leave the locals. You guys were pulling me down.
Look, if you ever see DJ Naves and if he knows you, be careful. His phone is always close by. He's always holding things over your head. You know, you'll be dancing, mind your own business. Next thing, you're on Instagram. So it's a warning, but a great guy and a pleasure to have him on the FisMaz Show. I hope you'll be back one day.
Definitely.
There's still a subject I want us to dive into. And I hopefully once we've revamped the studio and we can get two people in here, I want to hear the debate around what makes a big club. I know you're going
to
like
it's
that.
It's very important that we need to get into that.
We're not going to do
that. And we need to bring more people.
Yeah.
I think it needs to be a round table.
Yeah.
It needs to be six people and we need to discuss
Justin, Vikaran, you guys are hearing this? All right.
We need a round table. We need to discuss this thing. We need to film it and we need to get to the bottom of it, because people keep talking about big teams. But if they're not winning trophies, how are they a big team?
Well, you heard it here first. We're going to be debating a round table, hopefully. We'll unleash those dates in some time to come. But make sure you keep subscribing and downloading and interacting with us with regards to the FisMaz Show, and follow the Podzilla Media on all different platforms, on all social media platforms. And don't forget, you can get us on all major podcasting platforms. So that's DJ Naves. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
What's that? Sky's the limit.
Nah.
Is it Nyamang and Gan?
What?
Come on,
do you support Pirates?
I didn't say that.
I'm asking you.
No, I'm not. I'm not at liberty to disclose who I support.
Why?
No, I cannot. I have to be neutral.
You look like a Man United fan.
I definitely am a Man United fan.
Ah, loser!
That's where we close the show. All right, it's a wrap for the FisMaz Show. And we never want to see DJ Naves again. Bye-bye.
Go City!